Chances are you are a pretty big Harry Potter fan, or in fact a fan of books and reading full stop. I adore books, especially non-fiction books that allow me to learn new things about the world around me and even myself. However, it can be seriously difficult to find the time to read a book when you have like a million other things you need to do. Luckily, today's sponsor Blinkist are here to help. Blinkist is an app that condenses the best insights and need-to-know information from a huge selection of non-fiction books and condenses them into 15 minutes or so, which can either be read or listened to straight off their app. This means you don't have to read the entire book but can still attain the insight and important information it has to offer. Blinkist has a massive library covering genres like history, self-help, science, productivity, and creativity, just to name a few. If there's a non-fiction book you've had sitting on your shelf for ages and never had the chance to read it, there's a chance you'll be on here in a much easier to digest form. Recently, I've been listening to Gandhi's autobiography on Blinkist. You may remember a while back I made a video about the man. I didn't have the time to read his full autobiography in researching for that video, but now I can listen to the key points on Blinkist. I really could have done with this while making that video. I've been listening to it while doing chores around the house, out traveling, and even making these videos. A big part of my job is taking a huge amount of information and presenting it in a smaller and easier to digest way. And this is exactly what Blinkist does too. If you love my videos, then I have no doubt you'll love what Blinkist has to offer. Blinkist are offering the first 100 people to visit blinkist.com/nameexplain, which will be down in the description, unlimited access for a week, and then 25% off full membership after that. So what are you waiting for? Start learning with Blinkist today by visiting blinkist.com/nameexplain. And remember, those first 100 people get a week of unlimited access and 25% off membership. Thank you once again to Blinkist for sponsoring today's video. There are a few works of fiction that have caught the imagination of as many people as J.K. Rowling's Wizarding World, which of course is centred around the boy wizard Harry Potter, from the initial books to the big screen to theme park rides to countless Halloween costumes, which yes, ties this into being my Halloween video, but this video is going up the day after Halloween, so maybe it doesn't matter, I don't know. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is there's very little that hasn't been bestowed by the lightning bolt scar and circular spectacles of the boy who lived. Of course, it's not just Harry Potter himself that made this world so beloved. Rowling created a cast of wonderful characters, from Harry's classmates, his teachers and the staff of his school, to even the adversary he comes up against at his time in Hogwarts. And of course, all these characters have, you guessed it, names. Last time we looked into the names of a fantasy book, it was with the names of the Fellowship of the Ring in Tolkien's Middle-earth, with these names coming from the languages that Tolkien created to inhabit his fictional lands. Tolkien's Lord of the Ring, The Hobbit, and his other Middle-earth writings have been dubbed as immersive fantasy. They were dubbed this by fantasy scholar Farah Mendelssohn in her book, The Rhetorics of Fantasy. In this book, she broke the fantasy genre into four different subcategories, the first of these subcategories being immersive fantasy. This is the kind of fantasy in which the fantasy world of the story is all that is known, and no one questions the fantastical nature of it. Think of things like Tolkien's Lord of the Rings and George R.R. Martin's Song of Ice and Fire series of books. In these books, Middle-earth and Westeros are all the characters know. Portal fantasy is when characters from our normal world enter into a fantasy world through some means. The best example of this has to be C.S. Lewis's Chronicle of Narnia series, where the children discover Narnia via the portal in the wardrobe. Another great example is with L. Frank Baum's The Wonderful Wizard of Oz, in which Dorothy is transported from the ordinary Kansas into the magical land of Oz. Though what's interesting is that Wicked, the play and the book it is based on, is set entirely in the land of Oz, so this makes that immersive fantasy instead of portal fantasy. Liminal fantasy is a bit harder to understand. From what I've read, it's when elements of fantasy appear in our world, but they're perceived as normal. A great blog post, which will be linked down below, described it brilliantly. Liminal fantasy is built through the strong use of irony, juxtaposition, and toying with the reader's relationship with the text and their position relative to the protagonist of the story. By all means, our perception as readers tell us there's something fantastical and bizarre going on, but the text itself does not treat that fantastical bizarreness in any way that matches our gut reaction. It creates an off-kilter, dreamlike state where lines of all kinds are blurred and the very definition of ordinariness is muddled. Mendelssohn herself used the book Holes by Lewis Sicard as an example of this, where elements of folklore and hidden treasure are discussed in a very matter-of-fact way. And finally, we have intrusion fantasy. This is where the fantasy world and our real world coexist within one another, usually with the fantasy world hiding in plain sight of our real world. Examples of this are Derek Landy's called Dougley Pleasant series of books, which are seriously great, go check them out. And of course, J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter books, where the Wizarding World is hid through brick walls at train stations and various charms from us muggles. Anyway, what have these subcategories of fantasy got to do with the names of Harry Potter, I hear you asking? Well, I think quite a lot actually. As Harry Potter is an intrusion fantasy, it means that Harry's fantasy world and our muggle world coexist. This means that the names of characters can borrow from words and names of our own languages. languages and even draw from real things that exist or have happened on our planet, as opposed to say Middle Earth, where the names come from the languages of that world. This means that the names of characters in the Harry Potter books are linked to the elements of our real world, and these names often reflect the characteristics of the characters who have them. So let's look into how J.K. Rowling created names. Though I must admit, this won't cover every character in the books, as that would take way too long. Also, spoilers, I guess. Anyway, we should really look into the names of the Hogwarts faculty to begin with. Let's start off with the school headmaster, Albus Percival Wulfric Brian Dumbledore. Though we're going to be focusing on just those first and last names. Albus in Latin means white, and he could be called this for a couple reasons. White is often symbolized as the color for good and righteousness. As the books progress, Dumbledore becomes more and more the figurehead for the protagonists of the series. He's even the leader of the Order of the Phoenix, so this white in his name could represent what a good person he is. Though then again, I also read it could just reflect the fact his beard is white. Dumbledore is actually an old English word for bumblebee, as Rowling imagined the character pottering along the halls of Hogwarts humming to himself, much like a bumbling bumblebee mid-flight. Head of Transfiguration is Minerva McGonagall. This name derives from two very different locations. Her first name of Minerva comes from Roman mythology, as it's also the name of the Roman goddess of wisdom Minerva. This makes sense as Minerva McGonagall is portrayed as a very wise person, while her surname is the same as William McGonagall, a notoriously awful Scottish poet. It's been said that this mix of names of someone so wise and someone so bad at their job shows how Minerva herself can be wise and serious, but also have a fun side too. For the majority of Harry's time at Hogwarts, potion class was run by Severus Snape. Now, this is a name that is loaded with all kinds of interpretation. The name sounds like two words, severe and sever. The first of these means cruel and mean, which describes Snape rather well, while sever means to cut off, and this also hints at Snape's character arc, as it seems in the series he's cut off ties with Death Eaters and the Dark Lord. It also sounds similar to the Latin severus, meaning a servant, as he could be seen as a servant to the Dark Lord. Snape, on the other hand, doesn't have too much meaning behind it. Rowling has stated the name is based on someone she knew. It is also a town in England called Snape, and the word sounds similar to snap and snake. Snap is a word with negative connotations. To snap means to get angry, and Snape seems to be angry quite a lot of the time. And of course, Snape is heavily associated with snakes due to being a part of Slytherin. Rubius Hagrid was the Hogwarts gamekeeper and became the teacher of care for magical creatures. His first name of Rubius means red, though what that has to do with his character I'm not too sure. Though his surname of Hagrid is actually an old English adjective, which would be used if you had a bad night. I guess it relates to the modern word of haggard, though it's also thought to come from Norse origins. In Norse mythology, there was a giantess known as Grid, and Hart is an old Norse language element meaning half. So if you put these together for Hagrid, you get half Grid, or half giant, as Hagrid was of course half giant. Though we can't talk about staff members at Hogwarts without mentioning the plethora of Defense Against the Dark Arts teachers Harry had, the first of these being Quirinus Quirrell. The surname of Quirrell is thought to derive from Quirrell, meaning to argue, and it all sounds like squirrel. An animal often portrayed as shaken and scared, much like how he is. However, his first name of Quirinus means of two men, and this relates to the fact that he is actually two men, with the Dark Lord using his body as a vessel. Harry's next dat-dat teacher was Gilderoy Lockhart. It's thought that this first name derives from the ballad of a rather dashing highwayman who was also called Gilderoy, and Lockhart does see himself as the dashing highwayman type. How the surname Lockhart has a huge coincidental story behind it. J.K. Rowling has said she got the name by seeing it on a war memorial, though it also read there was a psychologist who was named Lockhart who specialised in the study of memory, which is fitting as Gilderoy Lockhart tampers with people's memories too. Next up, we had Remus Lupin. Understanding this character's name completely ruins the plot twist and mystery of the third book. Both names refer to wolves. His first name of Remus is a name shared with Remus of Roman mythology, the brother of the founder of Rome, and of course these brothers were raised by a wolf, and Lupin comes from lupus, which is Latin for wolf. This is because Lupin is a werewolf, but man, if you were given a name like Remus Lupin by your parents, part of me just thinks your folks knew you were getting bitten by a werewolf at some point. Either that or it's just one of the biggest coincidences. Wait, why is this bit the part of a series of books that includes magic and literal goblins the part I find hardest to believe? Next up, we had Alistair Mad-Eye Moody as Harry's teacher. Well, it wasn't really him, I know, and his surname simply means being in a bad mood, as Moody does come off as being rather moody. Though his first name of Alistair is a variation of the name Alistair, which is the Gaelic form of Alexander. The name Alexander means defender of mankind, and seeing as Alistair is an aura whose job it is to protect people from evil wizards, being dubbed a defender of mankind makes sense. The last of Harry's dat the teachers will be talking about is Dolores Umbridge. Despite her appearance, she is a vile woman. with her first name meaning Lady of Sorrow slash Pain. Her surname of Umbridge sounds like Umbridge, which means to take offense or feel resentment, as this is a way she makes a lot of people around her feel. While not a teacher or even a wizard, Argus Filch is one of the most interesting names in the series. His first name comes from Greek mythology, in which the Argus was a monster that had 100 eyes and could see everything. This reflects Filch as he is forever watching over everyone and everything, and usually ratting out our heroes. There is a name, however, in Harry Potter which I find more interesting than any other. And funnily enough, it's the name of He Who Must Not Be Named, which I've adhered to for the rest of this video. But that name is Voldemort. There are many interesting facts about this name. First off, being that Rowling herself stated that the T should be silent, making it sound like Voldemort, not Voldemort. However, everyone, including Rowling herself now, has gone on to pronounce the T. This name comes from the French Voldemort, which means flight from death, as he was able to escape from the clutches of death himself. Though he wasn't born with this name, Voldemort's birth name is Tom Marvolo Riddle. There isn't much to these names minus his surname Riddle, as the name is something of a riddle itself. The Tom and Marvolo parts are simply there to help with this riddle, as the name Tom Marvolo Riddle is actually an anagram of I am Lord Voldemort, which I'm guessing you will know anyway as you're watching this video. Though this created an issue in translations of the book, as this anagram needs to make sense in other languages too, so his middle name was different in different languages to help with this. In Italian, he became Tom Orvoloson Riddle, which became Son Io Lord Voldemort. In Spanish, Tom Sorvolo Riddle became Soy Lord Voldemort, and the one I liked most was French. To find the name that would spell out Je suis Voldemort, they went with Tom Elvis Jedusor. Suddenly, the Dark Lord doesn't seem as scary when he's sharing his name with the King of Rock and Roll. And of course, we have to cover the names of our three main characters, Hermione Granger, Ronald Weasley, and of course, Harry Potter. Let's start with Hermione. This first name means things like well-born and earthy, while her surname is thought to maybe come from the Granger movement of the 1800s, a movement with the aim of improving life for farmers in the UK. This sounds like the kind of thing Hermione would do. In fact, she does start her own movement for house elves with Spew. Ronald is a name that means advisor to the king, which is really fitting in regards to his and Harry's relationship, while Rowling gave him the surname of Weasley to reminisce the weasel, an animal that's often seen as a pest in the UK, but she has a soft spot for, much like how a lot of the people in the wizarding world view the Weasley family. And finally, we have Harry Potter, the single name that this franchise I've been talking about revolves around. And despite all the fantastical names with deep meanings we've looked into, Harry Potter as a name has none of this. Rowling has stated that the names Harry and Potter are just names she really likes. All in all, the name Harry Potter is just rather normal. I know people with the first name of Harry and with the surname of Potter, though I haven't met anyone with both of them yet. But I think this is the point. Going back to the idea that the Harry Potter books are intrusion fantasy, where normal people are thrusted into fantasy worlds. Here we have normal old Harry Potter being thrusted into the wizarding world. He's just a normal kid like you and I were when we first heard these stories, and this idea of him being completely normal is perfectly encapsulated with his completely normal name. Anyway, I've rambled on for far too long now, yet despite this there are so many names I didn't get a chance to cover, like Sirius Black, Bellatrix Lestrange, and even Draco Malfoy, plus the names of creatures and beasts and even other locations that Rowling created. I haven't even covered the house names, which reminds me, where are my Hufflepuffs at? There definitely are a lot more we can do here. A big shout out to MuggleNet and their name origins page that really helped make this video, and to the British Library's Harry Potter, History of Magic. The actual History of Magic event they held last year is what inspired this video. Now it's finally out and that's another one I can tick off. Now if you don't mind me, I'm going to go read some good old Lord of the Rings. Hey, I actually prefer those books. Thank you to all my patrons who support Name Explain on a monthly basis. Name Explain depends on small monthly donations from fans like you to help keep the channel running. Just a small amount of $2 a month helps in a huge way, grants you patron exclusive Name Explain extras, and gets your name here with all these awesome people. Thank you. Hello all, and thank you so much for reaching the end of the video. Stick around and check out another video and subscribe to stay up to date on all things Name Explain. You can follow myself on Twitter at NameExplainYT. Follow me there and tweet the name Frodo at me so I know you came from this message. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video, and once again, thank you all so much.